students. So students, in the last lecture we have studied about the menstrual cycle, right? So students, till date what all the topics we have studied in this chapter of human reproduction? So we have studied about the structure of male reproductive system, right? The male reproductive system produces male gamete, that is sperms. We have studied about the female reproductive system, right? Then we have studied about the gametogenesis processes, that is how a sperm is formed, which is a male gamete, and how an ovum is formed, which is a female gamete, right? So that is spermatogenesis and oogenesis, right? Then students, we have studied about the menstrual cycle, that are the cyclic changes which are seen in the female reproductive system during the entire period, right? So students, we have studied how gametes are formed, right? So our next topic will be fertilization, right? So once male gametes are formed and once female gametes are formed, then there will be fusion of this male and female gametes. That process is called as fertilization. Yes, students, so during sexual intercourse, we know that penis is the copulatory organ. Here students, you have to study a term, that is insemination, right? Insemination means the introduction or insertion of the male reproductive fluid, which is called as semen, into the vagina of the female reproductive system, right? That process is called as insemination. What is insemination? Insemination is the introduction or insertion of male reproductive fluid, right? The male reproductive fluid is semen, into the vagina of female reproductive system through the copulatory organ, that is penis, right? So insertion of the male reproductive fluid, that is semen, is inserted by the penis, which is the copulatory organ, into the vagina of the female reproductive tract. That process is called as insemination, and that process is performed during the sexual intercourse or during the coitus, right? So once sperms, right? So this semen is the male reproductive fluid, right? One ejaculate, right? In a single ejaculate, right? Around 3 to 3.5 ml of semen is inserted, right? So during one ejaculation, right, there is insertion of 3 to 3.5 ml of the semen into the vagina of the female reproductive system, right? So once the semen is inserted, right, we know the composition of semen, right? It consists of the secretions of various glands, male reproductive glands, that is seminal vesicles, prostate gland, bulbourethral gland, and there will be presence of the male gamete, that is sperms. So all of these things are present in semen, right? There will be fructose, there will be prostaglandins, there will be sperms, there will be energy nutrients which are provided to the sperms. So the semen is inserted into the vagina. Now there is liquefaction of this semen, which means semen was thick when it was inserted into the vagina. Now it is going to liquefy, which means it is going to get little bit diluted, liquefy, so that the sperms can attain the motility, right? Initially, when semen was inserted into the vagina through insemination, it was little bit thick in consistency, and then it gets liquefied, right, by certain secretions of the prostate gland, right? So now this sperms have to approach towards the ovum. So that is the first step of fertilization, that is movement of the sperm towards the ovum. So before that, we will study what is fertilization. Fertilization is fusion of male gamete plus female gamete to form a diploid zygote. That is called as fertilization, and the process is called as syngamy, right? The word itself says syngamy. Gamy is for gametes. So there is fusion, there is synchronization of the gametes. So that is syngamy. So fertilization is the fusion of the male gamete, that is spermatozoon, with the female gamete, that is ovum, to form a diploid zygote. That process is called as fertilization. Where exact does this fertilization takes place? What is the site of this fertilization? The site of fertilization is ampullary isthmic junction. Right? So the site is ampullary isthmic junction. What is it? We will study, right? You have studied it previously, right? So ampulla and isthmus are the parts of fallopian tube. So the junction of ampulla and isthmus is the site where fertilization takes place, right? Students, these are the steps of fertilization. We will study all the steps one by one. There is movement of the sperm towards the ovum. Then there is process of, during that process, there is capacitation, there is fertilizing, anti-fertilizing reaction, there is release of sperm lysins, right? Then reception cone or fertilization cone is formed, beginning of meiosis II, cortical reaction and fusion of the gametes. These are the steps of fertilization which we are going to study one by one, right? So yes, students, so we know that this is the ovary, these are the fimbriates, right, and this is the fallopian tube. This is the uterus and this is the vagina part, right? So through penis, penis is a copulatory organ. Through penis, the semen will be deposited into the vagina. And what will the semen possess? The semen will possess numerous sperms. How many sperms are present in a single ejaculate? One ejaculate will contain 200 to 300 million of sperms. Right? So one ejaculate is inserting 3 to 3.5 ml of semen into this vagina. So the amount of semen is 3 to 3.5 ml. And within the semen, how many sperms are present? 200 to 300 millions of sperms are present in a single ejaculate. So this is the semen, and the semen possesses sperms, right? The sperms are going to travel through this entire course of the uterus, right? It is going to travel through this entire course of the uterus, right? Say from here ovum is released, right? So say this is the released ovum. This ovum, actually we know at the time of ovulation, secondary oocyte is released. So this secondary oocyte is catched by the fimbriae, and where is it waiting for the sperm? It is waiting for the sperm at the junction between ampulla and isthmus. So this part is ampulla, this part is isthmus. So this is the ovum, right? So technically it is secondary oocyte, but we are writing it ovum. So ovum is present at the ampullary isthmic junction, and it is waiting for the sperm to reach to there and fertilize it, right? So this sperm has to travel this entire course, right? and then it is going to fertilize the ovum. So this fusion of the female gamete, that is ovum, and male gamete, that is sperm, that process is called as process of fertilization, and the site of the fertilization is ampullary isthmic junction. Clear? Now this is not a simple process as we are seeing it. There are lots of changes which are happening to favor this fertilization, right? So we will study all those steps one by one, right? So the first step is movement of the sperm towards the ovum, right? So first step is movement of the sperm towards the ovum. Sperm is moving towards the ovum, right? When the sperm is trying to reach towards the ovum, right, there are many things which are favoring, which are helping the sperms, and there are many factors which are acting as a barrier to the movements of the sperms. So what are those factors, right? Which are the factors which are acting as a barrier, which are preventing the movement of the sperms? Then the first one is acidic pH of vagina, right? So the sperms are deposited in the vagina. Now the pH of vagina is acidic pH, right? Which means it is acidic, right? So in this acidic pH, many sperms might get destroyed. So it is acting as a barrier, right? The acidic pH of the vagina is going to destroy many sperms. So it is acting as a barrier for the sperms to reach towards the ovum. Then the second barrier is thick endometrium. Endometrium is the innermost layer of the uterus. We know uterus is made up of three layers. Inner is endometrium, middle is myometrium, outer is perimetrium. Now the endometrium layer is so thick, right? So let me rub this. So this endometrial layer is so thick and highly folded and glandular that the sperms are getting very less space to move. So within this thick endometrium, the sperms has to travel through this thick endometrium. So it is also acting as a barrier, right? And the third barrier is phagocytes, right? So the female reproductive system will also have many phagocytes, right? There will be macrophages, right? And we know that sperm is a foreign material to the female body, right? So these phagocytes are going to attack the sperms, and those are going to try to destroy the sperms. So these are the barriers for the sperms to reach towards the ovum. The acidic pH of the vagina, which can destroy the sperms. Highly thick endometrium, which will provide hurdle to the movement of the sperms, and the phagocytes, right? The phagocytic activities of the cells, which are going to kill certain sperms, right? Now, which are the helpers, right? Which are the things that are helping the sperms, right? Then the first and very important is prostaglandins. Students, we have studied that the semen possesses prostaglandins, which are released by the prostate gland. These prostaglandins are nothing but made up of fatty acids and that 220 carbon arachidonic acid. Prostaglandins are made up of fatty acid, that is arachidonic acid, which is 20 carbon. So what is the function of this prostaglandins? It is going to induce the contractions of the uterus. So prostaglandins will induce the uterine contractions, mild uterine contractions, and in which direction, right? So the uterine contractions will be in such a manner that it is going to help the sperm to reach towards the ovum. So helper is release of prostaglandins, which will induce uterine contractions, inducing uterine contractions and helping the sperm to move towards ovum. Then the second helper is the lashing movements of the sperm itself, right? So lashing movements of sperms, and this lashing movements of the sperms is provided by Nabokon, and Nabokon is nothing but mitochondria, right? So this mitochondria, the spirally coiled mitochondria present in the middle piece, is giving energy to the sperms for their lashing movements so that the sperm can head towards the ovum, right? So this is the first step, that is movement of the sperm towards the ovum, right? The barriers are acidic pH, thick endometrial lining, and the phagocytic activities of the cells. And the helpers are the prostaglandins, which will induce uterine contractions to help the sperm to move towards the ovum, and the lashing movements itself of the sperms, which is provided by the mitochondria. The energy is provided by the mitochondria. So this is the first step of fertilization, that is movement of the sperm towards the ovum, right? So once there is insemination, that is deposition of the semen, there is liquefaction of the semen, and it is getting liquefied. It was thick, now its consistency is getting liquefied, and then the sperms are moving towards the ovum, right? While the sperms are moving towards the ovum, there is capacitation happening, right? What is this capacitation? Very important, students. The term is very important, right? That is capacitation, right? So the second step is capacitation, right? Very important term, right? What is capacitation, right? The sperms attain functional maturity in the female reproductive system by release of certain chemicals by female reproductive system. That is called as capacitation. So the process of attaining functional maturity, right? The sperms attain functional maturity. What is the meaning of functional maturity? So it attains maturity to penetrate the ovum, which means to penetrate ovum. That maturity is attained, that capability is attained by the sperms in the female reproductive system. So once semen is deposited, after that only the sperms attain the capability to penetrate the ovum, that is functional maturity. And who is helping in it? The certain chemicals which are released by the female reproductive system. That process is called as capacitation. This is clear, right? Once sperms are inserted, they attain their capacity, the maturity to penetrate the ovum. How they are attaining? Because of certain chemicals which are released by female reproductive system. That process is called as capacitation. So what happens, right? See, this is the sperm, this is the neck, this is the middle piece, and this is the tail portion of the sperm, right? The tip of the sperm possesses acrosome, right? And there are various chemicals which are present attached to the plasma membrane of the sperms. These chemicals are made up of sterols and glycoproteins, right? Now what happens in the female reproductive system, right? So female reproductive system releases certain chemicals, right? So these are the chemicals which are released by the female reproductive system. What is the function of these chemicals? These chemicals are going to attract these sterols and glycoproteins. So the sterols and glycoproteins are going to get attached with the chemicals which are released by female reproductive system. So now the tip of the sperm is no more covered by this sterols, which means now the plasma membrane is free to fuse with the plasma membrane of the ovum. Initially, the plasma membrane of the sperm was covered by these sterols and glycoproteins, so it will not be able to penetrate the ovum. But because of the release of chemicals by the female reproductive system, the sterols and glycoproteins are removed from the plasma membrane. Now the acrosomal membrane is also getting loosened to release the sperm lysine enzymes. This is clear, right? So that process is called as capacitation, right? There is release of chemicals by the female reproductive system to which the sterols and glycoproteins present at the tip of the sperms are getting attracted, so that the plasma membrane of the sperm is now free, right? The third step is fertilizing, anti-fertilizing reaction, right? So students, now what happens is that within this female reproductive system, this is ovary, this is fimbriae, this is the uterus, this is the vagina, right? So now, right, the sperm has gradually reached towards the ovum, right? At the ampullary stomach junction, ovum is waiting for the sperm to come and fertilize it, right? But see students, right, fertilizing is a chemical which is released by the ovum, right? So fertilizing is a chemical released by ovum. Anti-fertilizing is a chemical released by sperm, right? So I'm enlarging this diagram. This ovum, right, is releasing the chemicals which are called as fertilizing, right? So this are the fertilizers which are released by the ovum. These are the fertilizers, right? And sperms are releasing the chemicals which are called as anti-fertilizing. So sperms are releasing the chemicals which are called as anti-fertilizing. This anti-fertilizing is going to come and bind with the fertilizing of the sperm. What is the significance of this? The significance of this is that if there is matching, so students, you have studied about the stigma and pistil interaction, right? If they are of the same species, then only the pollen tube will be able to germinate. Otherwise, the pollen tube will not germinate. Similarly, if this sperm is of the same species to that of the ovum, then only this fertilizing and anti-fertilizing will match. There will be reaction, and then only this sperm is going to come and attach to the ovum, right? Once fertilizing and anti-fertilizing released by ovum and sperm respectively matches, then only the sperm is able to come and bind to the ovum. This is clear, right? So this is the third step of fertilization reaction, that is fertilizing anti-fertilizing reaction, right? Now the fourth step is release of sperm lysine enzymes, right? Students, let's first quickly study the structure of the ovum, right? Actually, at the time of ovulation, what is released is secondary oocyte, right? So this is the secondary oocyte, right? It is covered by a membrane. That membrane is called as plasma, membrane or vitelline membrane. That is the membrane. What is present within it? Within it, there is the presence of the nucleus, right? So this is the nucleus, right? Now this is covered by one more layer, that is glycoproteinaceous layer. That glycoproteinaceous layer is called as zona pellucida. Zona pellucida. The space between it is called as perivitelline space. This much is clear. And those are surrounded by many cells, right? And the appearance of the cells is in such a manner that they are seen in a radiating fashion, right? So the cells appear in a radiating fashion, and that is why these cells are follicular cells. An entire layer of the cells is called as corona radiata, right? So this layer is called as corona radiata. The side where nucleus is present is called as animal pole, and the opposite side is called as vegetal pole. Right? This entire structure is secondary oocyte. Right, students? So this is the structure of the released secondary oocyte. Right? The secondary oocyte is present. It is covered by a membrane which is called as plasma membrane or vitelline membrane. Inside it, there is the presence of nucleus. So this is the nucleus which is present inside it, right? Again, surrounding the plasma membrane, there is one more glycoproteinaceous layer which is called as zona pellucida. And surrounding it, there are follicular cells which are having radiating appearance, and that is why those layers are called as corona radiata. This is the structure of the released ovum, and released ovum is nothing but secondary oocyte. So students, which are the steps which we have studied till now? First is approach of the sperm, movement of the sperm towards the ovum. We have studied which are the helpers and which are the barriers. While the sperm is moving towards the ovum, it attains functional maturity. That process is called as capacitation, right? Then the sperms are releasing certain, so say this ovum is releasing fertilizing, right? So these are the fertilizings which are released. And the sperms are releasing anti-fertilizers, and through this anti-fertilizers only the sperms are going to come and bind with this fertilizers, right? So these are nothing but the chemicals that are fertilizers and anti-fertilizers which are released by ovum and sperm respectively. So now what is the scenario, students? The sperms have reached till the ovum, right? Where ovum is there, sperms have reached. How many sperms are able to reach towards the ovum? Only and only around 150 sperms are able to reach towards the ovum. So are you now able to get it, students, that why this much of sperms are released in a single ejaculate? Out of 200 to 300 millions of sperms, only 100 sperms can reach and can bind with this fertilizing chemicals which are released by the ovum. The rest of the sperms are either destroyed or those are behind. That is why the sperms are produced in such a large amount, right? Now what happens, right? Now which is the next step, right? The next step is so we have studied the three steps. The fourth step is release of sporulizins, right? The name itself says, right? So sperm, yahan tak to aa gaya hai, right? अभी उसको अंदर जाना है, स्पर्म हैज टू रीच, इट हैज टू रीच टू टिल द मेम्ब्रेन ऑफ द सेकेंडरी ओसाइट. सो देयर आर मेनी बैरियर्स, राइट? सो स्पर्म हैज टू क्रॉस इट, राइट? हाउ विल इट बी एबल टू क्रॉस इट? बाय वेरियस एंजाइम्स व्हिच आर रिलीज्ड, राइट? सो हु इज रिलीजिंग दिस एंजाइम्स, राइट? Who is releasing these enzymes? The acrosome, right? So acrosome, which was a cap-like structure, is going to burst, right? And it is going to release the enzymes. Those enzymes are called as sperm lysin enzymes. Which are the sperm lysin enzymes? The main sperm lysin enzyme is hyaluronidase and corona penetrating enzyme. These are the main sperm lysin enzymes, right? So देखो अभी अभी ये sperms है, right? ये penetrate होने वाला है, right? तो क्या करेंगे? The acrosome is going to burst, it is going to rupture, and there is release of sperm lysin enzymes, right? So this enzymes, first enzyme is hyaluronidase enzyme. What is the function of this hyaluronidase enzyme? Students, you can say these are all the follicular cells. All the follicular cells are binded together, and there is a matrix which is joining it. It is a glue-like thing that is made up of hyaluronic acid, right? So the cells are glued by hyaluronic acid, right? So this is hyaluronic acid. What is the function of hyaluronidase enzyme? This enzyme is going to break down the hyaluronic acid, so its pathway gets clear. And what is the function of corona penetrating enzyme? The name itself says the enzymes are going to help to penetrate the corona radiata layers. So what happens, students? The pathway of the sperm gets clear. There is one more enzyme, students, that is acrosin enzyme. This enzyme digest zona pellucida. This enzyme digest hyaluronic acid, right? So finally, zona pellucida is digested, hyaluronic acid is digested by hyaluronidase enzyme, and corona penetrating enzyme is helping in penetration. So now what happens? The sperm, right, some of these sperms, right, say over here the cells are present, right, but again this pathway is cleared, right? So some of the sperms are able to reach towards the ovum. Few sperms are able to reach, so that is called as release of sperm lysins. Those are the enzymes which are released by acrosome, is releasing this enzymes so that the sperm can penetrate. So this sperm is now able to penetrate. Again, this sperm is also now able to penetrate the all the layers of corona radiata, hyaluronic acid, zona pellucida, and where it has reached? It has reached up to the plasma membrane or vitelline membrane. This is clear, students? Right? Okay. Now the next step is formation of fertilization cone. Right? Fifth step is formation of fertilization cone, or it is also called as reception cone. Right? So say, students, this sperm, I'm enlarging it, right? This sperm has reached towards the plasma membrane or vitelline membrane. So now what happens? There is formation of a cone-like structure. That cone is called as fertilization cone or reception cone. This is clear? Yes, students, right? Now the next step is beginning of meiosis II, right? So students, we know that the released structure is secondary oocyte, which has started, right? Actually, we should say that not beginning but completion of meiosis too, right? So secondary oocyte has started the second meiotic division, it was arrested, if you remember, when we were studying oogenesis, right? And primary oocyte gets arrested in diploting phase, and secondary oocyte has begin meiosis too, but it is arrested in metaphase 2 of meiosis 2. Now just when the plasma membrane of the sperm binds or fuses with the plasma membrane of the ovum. So what happens? There is fusion of plasma membrane of the sperm and plasma membrane of the ovum. At that time, what happens? The secondary oocyte completes, right? Secondary oocyte completes meiosis 2. It was arrested in metaphase 2. Now if you remember the oogenesis, this is the secondary oocyte. When it completes meiosis 2, then two structures are released. One is ovum, which retains most of the cytoplasm, and the second structure is second polar body, right? So when this sperm fuses with the membrane of the ovum, right, this secondary oocyte completes the second meiotic division, and what is released? One second polar body. Say this is the second polar body which is released. Now this structure is called as ovum. What is it called as? It is called as ovum. Right? Then the next step is very important, students, that is cortical reaction. Right? What happens in it? Right? So let me remove all these things. So yes, students, right? Again, let me draw it in a simple manner, right? This was the plasma membrane, right? So this is the plasma membrane. Inside, right, this is the nucleus, right? So this is the nucleus. Now the ovum possesses ooplasm and exoplasm, right? The outer cortex part is called as exoplasm, which is dense, right? And the inner part is called as ooplasm. This is the vitelline membrane. Now when the sperm comes and fuses, right, when the sperm comes and fuses with the ovum, at that time what happens, right? In this exoplasm there are many granules which are present. Those granules are called as cortical granules, right? These cortical granules are going to stick towards the vitelline membrane, and it is going to form one more membrane. So there is formation of one more membrane, and in between it there is cortical granules present. This membrane is called as fertilization membrane. What is the significance? So this reaction is called as the cortical reaction. So what is cortical reaction, students? Formation of fertilization membrane by the deposition of cortical granules. So when one sperm fuses with the ovum, the membrane fuses, right? At that time the cortical granules which are present in the exoplasm are going to fuse with the vitelline membrane, and those are going to lift up the vitelline membrane. So vitelline membrane is lifted up, right? So it is like this now, right? This is the fertilization membrane. So what is the significance of it? This reaction is called as cortical reaction. And what is the significance of cortical reaction? Its significance is to prevent entry of other sperms, that is poly spermie, right? So if any other sperm comes and tries to bind with the vitelline membrane, it gets rejected, right? It is not allowed, right? So this cortical reaction significance is to prevent polysperm, right? If one sperm fuses, this sperm possesses haploid set of chromosome, the ovum possesses haploid set. So there will be fusion of the nucleus of the sperm and nucleus of ovum to form a diploid zygote. Now if one more sperm will come and fuse, then the ploidy will increase, right, which is not going to be happen. That is why to prevent polyspermy, to prevent entry of multiple sperms, cortical reaction occurs. What is cortical reaction? So there is formation of one more membrane, uplifting of the membrane. That membrane is called as cortilization membrane. Who is forming it? These cortical granules are helping in formation of it. And that is why it is called as cortilization membrane. Yes, students, and the next step, right? Last step is fusion of male and female gametes. Right, so students, now we know that this is over, right? Secondary oocyte has completed meiosis II, second polar body is released, and this structure is now ovum, right? So this structure is now ovum. Ovum, the size of ovum is 1000 times more than that of the sperm, right? This is the nucleus of the ovum, right? And the sperm is going to fuse with that of the ovum, right? Now what happens? The nucleus of the sperm is getting inserted into the ovum as well as centriole, right? So nucleus and centriole. This is centriole, this is nucleus. Proximal centriole and nucleus, both the things are inserted into the ovum. This nucleus will fuse with the nucleus of the ovum. The nucleus of ovum is called as germinal vesicle. That is the name given to it. Nucleus of the ovum is called as germinal vesicle. So nucleus of the sperm, right, say this is the nucleus of the sperm, it fuses with the nucleus of the ovum. That fusion is called as carrion, syncarion, and finally a diploid zygote is formed, right? So with this, the process of fertilization gets ended, right? There is formation of diploid zygote. So which are the steps, right? First is approach of the sperm, second is capacitation, third is fertilizing, anti-fertilizing reaction, fourth is release of sperm lysing enzymes, fifth is formation of fertilization cone, sixth is completion of second meiotic division, seventh is cortical reaction, right, and last there will be fusion of the male and female gametes. With this, a diploid zygote is formed. Now this zygote undergoes cleavage and forms 2-celled, 4-celled, 8-celled, 16-celled, 32-celled structures, and finally there is implantation process. We will study it in our next lecture.